focus, ideate, innovate, enable.
CEO is a unique magazine founded in October 2009 with the sole purpose of providing valuable information about entrepreneurship to the readers and aspiring entrepreneurs. Startup50 is a concept churned out by the leaders of Smart CEO with the intention to bring the investor and entrepreneur on the same platform to exchange ideas and valuable knowledge.
We started Smart CEO in October 2009 with a vision of becoming a platform for knowledge sharing by India's leading CEOs, CTOs, CFOs, CXOs from many different sectors. We actually started with a grand vision of trying to become the Harvard Business Review of India. We said we'll build a huge repository of content with a lot of insights through in-depth, in-person interviews with India's leading CEOs from many different sectors. We've been at it for about 7 years now, and we launched the Startup50 brand in 2015 with actually a slightly different a goal for growth mechanics and Smart CEO. We said at Smart CEO we have CEOs from many different sectors, but they're all on the same platform, and that didn't make a lot of sense. So we said we'll break it up into a collection of platforms. Startup50 is one such platform where it's a platform for CEOs of startups. We're building something called Family Inc. For leaders and chairmen and CEOs of family businesses in India. And I think over a period of time, smartceo.co, which is our digital platform, will become a collection of channels by sector, by city, and by stage of the business.
The event started with the keynote of Krishna Kumar Natarajan, Executive Chairman of Mindtree.
I think entrepreneurship is really a marathon. So you have to budget for segmented pain. It's not a sprint where you really start and sort of end within a very short span of time and sort of get the rewards for what you've done, but it's clearly a marathon. And more than anything else, one thing we have realized is that building an institution takes time. You cannot sort of do it overnight. It has to be built brick by brick, and there are really no shortcuts. So while Prem said idea to IPO, I think a lot of us dream in terms of not just an IPO, but can we become a very successful listed company with at least $1 billion of entity? But the odds for that are really very, very high. So in a way, I think you have to think that not every idea really gets funded, which means I think 1 in 50 ideas really even become a business. And 1 in 20 of that really reach to an IPO stage. Yeah. And 1 in 20 of a public company reaches $1 billion revenue. So this is what David Thompson in his book, A Blueprint to Billionaires, said. So what you must really realize is the odds are 1 in 20,000 for you to build a successful listed company which reaches $1 billion. So in a way, I think it's very important to be a part of the process and really enjoy, but very consciously do what you think is right, because the odds are really, really very, very high. But also make it enjoyable for you to do that. I think that's really what is the end outcome which each and every one of us are trying to achieve.
I'm here to talk to you about a cool, open, and creative country. One that is a globally connected tech hub. An island off the European continent which offers a thriving ecosystem. I will bring Ireland to you. A country most US-based startups and tech companies would have used as a base for growth in the EMEA region. I would encourage you to look at Ireland to set up your EMEA headquarters or your besides India headquarters, and you will find that the IP that you park in Ireland, it'll be safe, as well as there will be benefits accruing to it. There are R&D grants that I've already touched on. There are a lot of benefits that come to companies besides just the fact that it's easy to set up, it's easy to do business in Ireland, and there's very low bureaucracy levels. How do we help? We talk to companies, we engage with them to see what their plans are. We then work to see whether Ireland works for them. And if it does, we encourage them to visit Ireland. We set up meetings for companies. These would include meetings with peers. This could be with potential client companies. This could be with professional bodies like law firms, accountants, recruitment companies, bankers. And basically, we can even help you find space. So basically what we do is we handhold you to the extent you require. to see if Ireland suits you. We help you fill up your business plan so you know how much it's going to cost you going 3 to 5 years from now. And then when you're ready to set up, we again help you with all the formalities. If there is any kind of grant that you could be eligible for, we even help you with that. And going further, just to help build your brand in Europe, we will help. We would have an announcement either by a government official, a minister, again, depending on what you would like to achieve. And we found that this kind of announcement also helps raise the brand of Indian companies that are not so well known in Europe.
I presume at this stage you've already assessed most of the basic idea, you've validated your idea, you validated many of the assumptions which you'd made on that, and you've also actually had a chance to assess whether your strategies are truly disruptive, because you really do need to do something differentiated or disruptive in any startup. The next thing I think you really need to ask yourself is, are your planned differentiators real and defensible? I think this is a really important part, and when you look at it, and I'll give you two examples of entities which have got started and where one has hit into huge issues of defensibility and the other succeeding rather well. The first one is obviously the e-commerce world, where they come in with a flourish, and now what do you see? That the moment one big giant came into the market, really the majority of them have collapsed or are on their way to collapsing. And I think it's only Flipkart. And it's not really because it's Flipkart alone. It's Flipkart funded by SoftBank. So it's really a battle more between SoftBank and Amazon. It's not unlikely that Paytm will be the third survivor because it'll be funded by Alibaba. But you can also see what has happened here, that you have a market which is really growing and expanding. Everybody rushes into it. And then when you get into this market, you find that the competition really got excessive. The net result is down rounds. And after that, businesses tend to collapse. Just as the digital world today presents huge opportunities, it also is full of threats. The pace of change is accelerating everywhere. And if you're not continuously innovating, then if you disrupt it today, you'll become the disruptee tomorrow. So I won't really give you any advice on that at the moment, except to tell you just one quick thing, that whenever you do that, I think you have to take that process up at least 12 months or 18 months before you actually reach the stage. There's a lot of preparation to be done. How you will size your issues, how you will price your issue, all of that is something very important to consider. So thanks a lot. Nice speaking to all of you.
It's always great to look at so many startups, so many ideas. This year, one was the agri-tech, and two was, I think, the quality of the entrepreneurs and the quality of the entrants of the business plans that we received. The kind of work was really astounding. And it also made me feel very jaded and old, right? Because so many ideas and so much of enthusiasm and passion that came through was really good. It also made me feel inadequate because almost half of the startups, I just couldn't understand, okay, right? So personally, it has a lot of learnings for me. I want to share some of the thoughts on what I have learned out of all of this. Before you start your venture, or while you're starting your venture, before you go and raise money, before you scale, before you do anything, do your homework and do your planning, okay, right? After you have done all that, you are willing to swear by it and write it in blood and put it out there, then multiply everything by 3. Because when shit hits the roof, it really hits. Okay, right? And I have seen it takes 3 times the effort, 3 times the capital, and 3 times the time to achieve whatever you have finally honed in on. That's called the rule of 3. 3 times the capital, 3 times the time, 3 times the effort. That is what it will take. Believe me, all of you would have heard in recent times after the bull market turned bearish and downward valuation started. Don't focus on vanity metrics. Vanity metrics does not just mean GMV or growth or something like that. Focusing on the wrong metric instead of the right metrics. Okay, right? You need to know at every stage of the company what you're trying to what are you trying to optimize for. This is almost like a linear programming problem. Don't expand before cracking the code. So that's a very important decision before you grow. Because this entire concept of
cookie cutter approach or economies of scale doesn't really apply. A lot of times it's problems of scale. So unless it's really something which you can replicate 100% easily, don't scale before this.
On the other side, we will see the highlights of a panel discussion on funding and scaling. The panel discussion on funding and scaling highlighted the importance of focus on business idea and various other things which are important for a startup to grow.
When you listen to a pitch from an entrepreneur, what are you thinking? What are you noting down? What are you looking for? Can you give us a sense of, you know, what goes on inside the VC's head when you're meeting an entrepreneur for the first time and listening to his pitch?
Yeah, that's a great question. And these days, while at least at Lightbox, we're not focused on seed, we end up doing A and later, I think it's pretty close to the same kinds of things that we look for. I would say that as a starting point, and I know you've probably heard this many times before, but I'm trying to figure out, you know, how deeply passionate this entrepreneur is, you know, how hungry and motivated this entrepreneur is. Obviously, as part of that, we want to make sure that there's a large enough market so that even if things don't go as planned, you know, we have time to grow into that business, or, you know, or if the model is not right, we have enough room for making mistakes, because we have to recognize that many mistakes will be made, and we want to plan for that. And so we want to make sure that the market is large enough, and that there is a strong team behind it. That's what we look for, is the strength of the entrepreneur.
Paul Graham of Y Combinator wrote that, you know, the same pitch, you know, given by two different entrepreneurs can have the complete different effect on the investor.
Typically, of course, that's, you know, it's the connect we look for with the entrepreneur. As Prashant rightly said, you have to work with these people for a 7-year period. And it's very similar to when you are, you know, of course, there are love marriages and there are arranged marriages, right? So in a love marriage, you know, it's a connect that happens. When you connect with the person, you just like the person, right? So, and there are so many things that you're looking for in a person. And if you feel that, yes, this is the person I would like to spend the rest of my life with, it just, you know, happens. Unfortunately, I have to give the money back to the people I've raised the money from, right? So, and one of the, so I've been in the same shoes as the entrepreneur when I was standing in front of those LPs, right? So that I'm actually promising them that, you know, give me your money for a period of time and I'll make sure that I'll bring this money back with the returns which will be better than what you can get from other investments, right? So there, and these are high risk investments and therefore they expect higher returns. So from that perspective, you know, I have no option, but I have to look at how I will get my money back out of this. So that's actually one of the most important criteria for my evaluation.
How do you value seed stage companies, and how often is the valuation the reason to say no or yes?
To me, after what has already been said, I spend a lot of time in understanding what is the differentiated value proposition of this company. And I can tell you 90 out of 100 companies that I see who come to us can't truly put the finger on what is that, right? So is there an IP? Because we look at technology companies, and I come from technology background, I'm looking at technology depth. Is that IP? Is that technology depth? Do they have good understanding of competitive landscape? You'll be shocked to know that people come with product ideas and they want to design global products, and they haven't even done a global competitive analysis to be able to say how will this product stand against these global products. So that is very important for me. So in one word, differentiated value proposition. And if there's IP, there's business model, there's process IP, whatever kind of IP is there, I want to have deep understanding of that.
A piece of advice for entrepreneurs. How should they react to a no?
I think you know, rejection is obviously something which is part of the venture capital experience. I think we all, you know, we are all on this journey, whether we are seeking the ideal company or we are seeking the ideal LPs. So even the entrepreneur has to look at it this way, that even the VC has a god sitting above him who are called the LPs. So to that extent, I think when the entrepreneur faces rejection, first of all, I think they need to kind of get the feedback as directly as they can from the investors, because that's certainly part of the storyboarding or story building. It's immensely helpful. I think it's important to get rejected, because I think you can build that your own business model. You have to be prepared with a refined, robust business model, and rejection is part of that journey to getting there.
It's time for a short break. On the other side, we will see the 50 enterprises which were rewarded for their exceptional success and growth.
When we launched the brand Startup50 in the year 2015, we told ourselves that we'll stick to three different rules, which we'll never go back on. One is have a very fair and transparent jury process. Two, have representation of various sectors and industries in the Startup50 community. So we have, as part of Startup50, we have companies ranging from fintech, financial services, retail, social impact, not to forget consumer and enterprise tech. The reason for this is we wanted to make sure, to showcase that the Indian entrepreneurship ecosystem is not just tech. So the third point is we don't want Startup50 to be a regular annual event. We wanted to run some interesting programs for the Startup50 alumni, and also publish books on the Startup50 brand, though some of these are at a slightly early stage.
The core components for Startup50 to do well over the long term was to have a top-notch jury in place. So how does the jury work? So we start with a pool of 500 companies. These are 500 companies that SmartCEO Editorial is very, very excited about. They're from multiple different sectors: healthcare, fintech, enterprise tech, consumer internet, social impact, agri, and a whole lot of other sectors, including education and enterprise services. Out of these 500 companies, we're actually excited about all, but we had to look at data. So we partnered with Venture Intelligence, which is a data firm, to look at hardcore financial data as reported in the MCA. We went through a rigorous process of analysis, and then we picked 150 companies to take to the jury meeting. When the jury actually is making its decision, there's one question we actually go back to after every discussion. If I were part of an investment committee, would I actually invest in this company? Would I actually take one more meeting with this entrepreneur? And I think that was a very, very important way to run the jury meeting, because then we were very serious about it. And that's how we picked India's top 50 companies.
The company to win the first award.
The 50
is
winners
Indus
were picked
OS.
From a pool of over 400 startups. It was a stringent process undertaken by a panel of industry experts, which included the names such as Amit Patni, founder, Ray Global and Nirvana Venture Advisors, Ganapati Venugopal, CEO, Axilla Ventures, K. Ganesh, founder, Growth Story and chairman, Portea Medical, Naganandor Swami, founder and partner, Idea Spring Capital, Shubhankar Bhattacharya, venture partner, K. Capital, and Shajikumar Devkar, managing partner at IFL Wealth.
The first category is enterprise tech and startups to win the award. The next category, ladies and gentlemen, is financial services and fintech. So, ladies and gentlemen, the next category is healthcare, preventive health, and digital health. And the next category, ladies and gentlemen, is consumer tech. And the next category, ladies and gentlemen, is consumer brand category. And the next category, ladies and gentlemen, is social impact. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we're moving towards the last and final category of awards this evening, agriculture and agri-tech.
We help Indian companies set up in Ireland. Ireland has strengths in certain sectors, namely the financial services sector, the technology, which is IT, as well as services, and the life sciences sector. Startup 50, the companies that have applied and won as well, transgress all these sectors, and therefore we've worked actively with most of these companies to see if Ireland could be an option for them when they look at globalization. We're proud to say we've got Tech Mahindra, Infosys, TCS, smaller companies like Kelton Tech and IIT Limited, and companies across the life sciences space as well in Ireland.
The event ended on a high note with all the investors and entrepreneurs coming together to appreciate the initiative taken by Smart CEO and its team to recognize the efforts of rising entrepreneurs of India.
Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.